Yes, miss. It will be so hard.
If you'd only come the first time, I'd apologize.
Sure, I was with the Hinds, miss.
I know. Where's Master Eddie?
Gone to the train, miss.
Why so?
I don't know, miss.
He put on his new suit after breakfast.
And I heard him tell his papi he was going to meet the train.
Oh, to be sure. Miss Lambert's amongst the arrivals. Which brings us back to business, Helena. She better have gone to bed.
Oh, she don't like that room, miss. Tis too noisy. Tis number 10 she always has.
Very well, 10 for her. Then there's Mr. Cronin and Mr. Hunt.
Oh, the men about the land.
The gentlemen from the Land Commission. Let them out 12 and 13.
Neither of them will not be 13. Them commissioners are very suspicious.
Well, we can give them 11 and 12.
The master said no one was to go into 11 until he'd have a bed prepared.
Well, we can give them 9 and 10.
Sure, you've put Miss Lambert into 10.
Good gracious me, what should we do at all?
Tis easy enough, miss. What's wrong with 15?
To be sure, it's a double bed.
But Mr. Hunt will be glad of it. 16's known if he's not.
No, I'm keeping that room for Mr. de la Mer and Miss Constancia.
Miss Constancia? Glory, miss!
Quite all right, Helena. Actresses they are. I mean, she's an actress and so is he. He's an actor and so is... Well, anyway. They're man and wife these years and years. O'Hara or some name like that, I believe they are, really.
I see.
Where are we at? Miss Lambert in number 12.
Let you leave it to me, miss. I'll straighten it out. Mr. Hunt, number 12. Miss Lambert, 10. Mr. Cronin, 14. And the Playacres, 15.
I believe there are one or two others coming, but I've lost a bit of paper.
It doesn't matter much, miss. Sure, there's lashes of rooms.
That's a good girl. But mind, no fuss or excitement. Be cool in business life. I suppose the master's gone to the train, too?
Yes, miss. And the mistress is in her bedroom trying on some dresses. He came from Dublin by the first post.
More dresses? What about the one she got for the races only 10 days ago?
I know, miss. Stacks of them she has. But she said she'd be out at the theatre every night for nearly the next month.
Of course, I forgot. Oh, well, here's our first arrival. Well, Miss Lambert, it's well you are. How are you at all, Todd?
Good morning, Miss Swift. How are you, little Stephen?
Can't complain, thank God.
And how are you?
Not very well, miss.
It's been a grand summer so far, hasn't it?
Yes, indeed. But Dublin has been stifling. I was glad you got out of it.
Oh, I'm sure you were. Ah, well, the sea breezes will soon bring the colour back to your cheeks. Not indeed that you're looking pale, but... Nowadays, there's no telling the natural bloom from the rose.
Miss Julie.
Only my little joke to hear you must mind me. Sure, when you're young, you might as well be dead as not to be in fashion.
Don't I remember?
Helena, run and make Miss Lambert's cup of tea.
Oh, please don't bother.
Oh, no bother at all. I always have one myself about this hour to short in the morning. Hurry, Helena.
Yes, miss.
I had breakfast on the train.
Oh, sure, that's hours ago. What you should have is a cup of tea and a nice little nap, and then you'll be in smart shape for your lunch.
Indeed, no. I must put in an appearance at the factory before lunch, and let the secretary know I've arrived.
Oh, let the factory wait. How long will you be staying?
3 or 4 weeks, I suppose. It always takes about that long to get through the factory's accounts.
That's grand news for Eddie. How when you found out the train you were coming on.
Ah, go on, Auntie.
I wouldn't believe it was the Inish station. Eddie wasn't waiting on the platform for me.
Indeed, but he's a faithful boy. I can tell you, Miss Lambert, there's girls breaking their hearts in Inish for Eddie, but not to look when he looked at one of them. No, his heart's stuck away up in Dublin.
No, Eddie, there's a reputation you're getting.
Go on, Christine.
While Helena's wetting the tea, I just slip upstairs to see his room all right. Poor Helena, willing enough, but no system. We're putting you into number... What number at all is it?
I'm generally a 10.
That's it! 10, of course. Helena, says I. 10 Miss Lambert's accustomed to have it, and 10 she must get. Well, I'll be back in a few minutes. I'm leaving you in careful hands.
Very nice to be back again, Eddie.
Is it? Do you really mean that?
Of course I do. It is very nice of you to meet me at the station, and that's a very nice suit you put on. In fact, everything's very nice.
I got it last week for you. I mean, against your coming.
It's great extravagance. Did you get one before you came up to Dublin for the spring show?
I did.
I don't believe your auntie's right at all. I believe we've fallen for that pretty Miss McCarthy,
Have you changed your mind at all?
No, I did not at all. You're a dear nice boy, and I'm very fond of you, but I don't want to marry you.
Let's see, well, maybe you change your mind. What about Margaret Wolfe this afternoon?
Pause. I forget I'm here to work. After tea, maybe it's like 10:09 these evenings?
I'm taking you to the theatre tonight.
The theatre? The pavilion? Maybe I'm sick of those comic strips. I don't think I can laugh on them, they're very stupid and vulgar.
They're not comics. Just you wait and see. We're running a first-class repertory company this summer.
For what?
Intellectual sort of things. You know.
You're joking.
Not at all. You know why Inish has been going down these past 2 summers, with more and more people going to Shangri Strand, just because the bathing was better. And then that truth that was here last summer was the limit. Too vulgar altogether, real low.
Comicalities. Wasn't that what they called themselves?
Yes. Anyhow, the Monsignor got a lot of complaints about them. So he and Pappy, Peter Hurley, the TD, put their heads together and decided something must be done to improve the tone of the place. And so, the Dillemere Repertory Company is opening their season tonight.
Goodness sake, I don't think I've ever heard of them.
Oh, they're very high class, I believe. Do nothing but serious stuff. Russian plays and all that sort of thing. Just what you like. I've got to prepare season tickets, so wait a minute.
I'll go tonight certainly to San Bolo. What's the play?
I forget. There's a headline. I know Wednesday night is a doll's house. I remember that because it's such a funny name. And either Thursday or Friday there's the power of darkness. Isn't there a play called that?
Yes, but Inish will never support that sort of stuff.
Well, we'll give it a try anyway. Didn't you see Pat down at the station?
Yes, in the middle of a lot of queer looking people.
That's them? I mean, that's the repertory company. The two principals, Mr. Dillamay and Constance are stopping him. Putting them up for free because, of course, Pappy owns the pavilion. I suppose they'll be along in a few minutes. They had a deal of baggage to look after.
I think this is the most exciting. They'll be more comic than the comicalities anyway.
I was dead keen for them to come.
Why, Eddie?
Well, I feel very ignorant alongside you, Justine. You get books in Dublin, you go to plays and things. I don't get a bit here. I thought these plays would improve my mind type.
You have a very nice mind, will you leave it alone?
I know, I'm only ever going to punch you out. You're right to keep on refusing to marry me. But maybe by the end of the summer.
The play actors are coming, miss. Oh my god, that's a truck of them. Such boxes you've never seen. And your number 10 is in case Miss Twig makes any mistake.
All right, Helen.
There's a couple of chairs. Constance. Miss Constantia, I mean.
Thank you.
Yes, Miss Lambert. I now confine myself entirely, with the cooperation of Miss Constantia, to psychological and introspective drama, The Great Plays of Russia, an Ibsen or two, Helter Strindberg. I think very little of the French.
The much here was getting against French, please.
He was perfectly right. French theatre is superficial, no feeling for the psyche of the flesh. Flesh. The English theatre.
We cut. Things being the way they are, the safer keep up English plays this summer.
He loses with little. Of course, there is Shakespeare.
Of course.
My Lady Macbeth, do you remember Hector and Dundee?
Perfectly, darling. A most marvellous performance, Miss Lambert.
Oh, I love Macbeth. The last Lady Macbeth I saw was Mrs. Patrick Campbell's.
Oh, poor Miss Pat. Did you like her?
Immensely.
Really?
Here's my wife, Annie. This is Miss Constantia.
How are you, Miss Constantia?
How do you do?
And my sister is doing. Mr. Delapere, my wife. My sister. My sister has a bit of run at the calendar shop. Gives my wife more time to think of dresses and falafels.
Get away with you, John. Miss Lambert, dear, I never saw you. How are you?
Splendid, Mrs. Stewart.
Oh, you're looking very smart. That's a dirty little suit you're wearing. Tell me, where did you get it?
What did I tell you? Clothes all the time.
Wish I don't mind, John. You'd be the last one to me to go around town looking like an old rag bag. What was it, Dan?
I'll just run up to my room and wash my hands. I'll be back again to have my cup of tea with Miss Stewart.
Will I carry your case off?
No, Michael will have it taken up, I'm sure. Stay where you are.
I think we might all have a little tea.
I have something here that will do Mr. Delamere better than tea after his long journey. What about a drop of whiskey syrup?
I rarely touch anything during the day, till after the show, except in the most exceptional circumstances.
Well, glory be to goodness! Could any day be more exceptional than today? High class plays are finished. Come now, I'll take no denial.
I warn you, Mr. Delamere, my brother will find some excuse to make every day and every hour of the day exceptional. Helena fills that decanter every morning. Many is the evening we have to sit down to the bar for a fresh bottle.
Ah, what's the matter, woman dear? A little drop for you, Miss Constantia.
Nonsense. A nice creamy cup of tea is what Miss Constantia would like. Don't I know?
Can't you let her speak for herself?
I confess I am partial.
To a small whiskey and soda.
That's the spirit. These women of mine take nothing but tea, tea, tea all the day long. Bring along the siphon, Eddie. I have it here packed.
I hope we'll be able to make your stay here comfortable, Miss Constantia. If everything's not to your liking, you must just come to me. Helena the servant is as winning as can be, but flighty, no head on her at all.
I'm sure we shall be most comfortable.
This place is quite a home from home. That's what a traveller wrote in our book one day. Very clever and terse, don't you think?
Oh, quite.
Now, Miss Constantia, Mr. Delamere, here's your very successful season.
And here's to you, sir, and to Inish. May our visit to the town be profitable. Spiritually, I mean.
I should like to associate myself with Mr. Delamere's remarks.
Faith, I hope it'll be profitable in every way. Them comicalities last year had me on the brink of ruin.
Indeed, they were very low.
I hope, Mr. Julian, you'll not put too much store by material profits. Plays of this kind draw very small audiences and make very little money.
Why do you know anything and so? If it's not a rude question.
Because it may revolutionize some person's soul.
Ah, sure. We've had enough of revolutions.
I mean to say that a young man in the audience may see himself there on the stage, in all of his lust, in all his selfishness, in all the cruelty of his youth. A young man such as your son.
Is it poor Eddie? There never was a more innocent boy.
I meant nothing personal. Or some middle-aged man, in all outward appearances respectable, would see himself stripped naked, the sham cloak of virtue torn from his shoulders, and he will stand exposed as the rotten sham that he is. Women will see themselves vain, shallow, empty-headed, scheming for power, scheming for husbands, scheming for lovers.
Heaven defend us!
It's like a mission.
It is a mission, Miss Tuig. A tremendous mission, where the pulpit is the stage and the great dramatists speak the sermons. I am myself a convert.
Do you mean you used to be a Protestant?
I'm not speaking in the strictly religious sense. It happened more than 20 years ago. I was a very young man in Cork, and there came to the opera house once or twice a year a company headed by Octavia Kenmore and her husband. Her repertory Ibsen plays. They played to wretchedly small audiences, and I went every night. To the gallery, I was very poor. I saw every rotten sham in Cork exposed on that stage. I could translate some plays in terms of South Mall, or Montenotte, or Sunday's Well. I saw myself on that stage, young puppy that I was.
Oh, no, Mr. Delamere, I'm sure you remember that.
I was. But those plays changed the current of my life.
And did they change Cork?
No, they did not. We played there 2 summers ago to the same miserable audiences of cynical people, the same corruption, public and private.
Ah, well, here in Inish, we don't think much of Cork. But you find us quiet, decent people. I don't think there's much here to expose at all. Is there any?
Sorority? Just too quiet we are. Not when I watch murders or big crimes or anything of that sort. Heaven forbid. But we often find ourselves blue moldy for want of an innocent scandal to open. We women can't live without it. Am I right, Miss Constantia?
Oh, to speak no scandal, no, nor listen to it. Ever my motto, Mrs. Tuig, ever my motto.
And a very nice one too, my dear.
Always merry and bright. That was someone's motto, wasn't it?
That, I believe, excerpt of a vulgar musical comedy.
Ah! Here's me, Bola Peter. Mr. Delamere, I'd like to introduce to you our local TD, Mr. Peter Hurley.
How are you? I am honored to meet you, Mr. Hurley.
And this is Miss Constancy.
How are you, Miss? Morning, Annie. Morning, Lizzie.
Morning, Peter.
What about a drop of whiskey, Peter?
Ah. No, thank you, John.
You can chance it. The Dale's not sitting now.
Things being in the air, you might be summoned any minute. And may I ask, Mr. Hurley, which party you represent?
Oh, Peter's a sound government man, aren't you, Peter? Always on the spot, your vote is wanted. He's not much of a speechifier, Mr. Delamere, but he's a sound party man. Did you speak at all into the Dale, Peter? I don't believe you did.
I missed twice in one day, but someone else was quicker.
They also serve, Mr. Hurley. They also serve only stand and wait.
Thank you, sir.
Never mind, Peter, my son. You'll come out strong one of these days. There's a whiskey for you. I won't take no.
Ah, thank you, John. Here's to us all.
Perhaps we should be going to the hall, Hector.
I'm afraid Murphy won't have the scene set for another hour.
And it will be nearly time for your dinner then.
Oh, and I must
Auriele. Take my hands.
Wait. Will.
Thank you, Hector.
But to make sure, please doubly sure, if the company will excuse us, we shall retire to our room and go over the scene there.
Certainly, certainly.
What is it you want to do?
Just to run over a short scene that's in the play tonight. We can do it in our room.
With actions?
With, as you say, actions. Of course, without props.
Props?
Properties. The correct furniture. The samovar, the empty little cradle.
Well, indeed, I've seen that room since all your boxes went up. Between them and the big double bed, there's not room, as they say, to swing a cat. Besides, Helena hasn't the room tidied up yet.
Dear, dear.
What's the matter with this room? It's a big, hairy room. And you're welcome to be rid of it. Sure, when the Temperance Society was putting on to quite a last winter, his earrings to hold their practices.
But so inconvenient for you all.
Not at all. We can go down to the bar. And I'm sure my wife will want to be showing Lizzie all the grand dresses she got in Dublin this morning. Come on, all of you.
Oh, but it seems so cruel to disturb you.
Not another word. Come along.
Happy?
Well, son,
ask them could I stay.
Stay? Nonsense.
Ask them, Pappy.
What is that?
A bit of nonsense, it is. He wants to stay and hear you.
No, no, my boy. Wait for the real thing tonight.
Hector!
A moment.
He must stay. They all must stay. I must have an audience. At least 3 or 4 people will make all the difference to me. Tell me if I vibrate or if I do not vibrate. Mrs. Tui, I implore you, lend me your ears and your heart. You are a mother. I am a mother in this play, an erring one, I admit, but still a mother. I entreat you, stay and hear me. Well, stay if that's the way you feel about it. And Lizzie too.
I'll wait. Sure, my tea's due any minute.
Oh, thank you, thank you. Hector, set the stage.
Well, John, I have to be off. I have to see the Monsignor.
Right on, Peter. You'll be in the pavilion tonight.
Oh, I will, to be sure.
We all really want to over here, on this side. Now, I needn't explain the whole play to you. This is the scene which closes the fourth act. The scene is a small kitchen in Russia. There is a large Russian stove, a samovar, of course, on this table.
A what?
A samovar. Of course you know what that is.
Of course.
Miss Constantia's name is Alina. She's a poor Russian servant whom I have betrayed earlier in the play. My name is Michael.
Have they a name like that in Russia? I thought Michael was a good Irish name.
It is a very common name in Russia.
And do they ever shorten it to Mick?
No. Well, meanwhile, she hasn't seen Michael for several years, and she's had a baby.
Oh, the creature!
This is the scene of their meeting. Perhaps Master Eddie can hold the book. Bottom of that page, and don't prompt unless we're really dry.
Dry?
Fluff.
I'm broken a cradle. Going to empty cradle. Heaven's name, what for?
Shh! Ready, Constance?
Yes.
I am
which told me, Lena, you,
Michael.
Yes, it is I, Michael.
Why have you come back into my life?
I did not know you were here. You ran away from old Alex.
He beat me.
Where did you go?
To Moscow. To Niji. To Tobolsk. To anywhere.
Why are you rocking a cradle, Alina?
Can you ask that, Michael?
But it is empty.
Indeed, it is empty.
Why is it empty?
My baby is dead. Our baby is dead, Michael.
Our baby? I do not understand.
Do understand, betrayer?
Thank you. I tore my dress at the matinee and I must mend it before the next show.
If things continue the way they're going, you'll be able to have a dresser next week. Imagine that.
Imagine. I've attended dresser for years.
I just told Murphy to reserve another row of seats for tonight and to further notice.
Isn't it marvelous?
It just bears out what I've always said. Give people the right stuff, well put on and intelligently acted, and they will support it. I hear there weren't 100 people in the picture house last night.
Oh, splendid! How I hate those pictures!
The first 3 days of this week are £14.02 better than the first 3 days of last week. We are clear £20 in the good already. We'll be over 40 by the end of the week.
We'll be able to settle that account with the birds, or so odious, threatening us with his writs.
And we can settle with Kelly and Shay at hotel in Carnham.
Would there be enough for me to send him rather a little? Poor darling, she's so hard up.
Of course. Let's send her £5. That'd be a nice surprise for her. Oh, and I was thinking of Uncle Bill.
What about him?
I thought he might join us. He's a good old character actor.
Darling, he's so very old and he does get so very drunk.
I know, but he ought to have a share in our success. After all, he taught me my first stage lessons.
All right, let's just send him some money.
All right, anyway. But you must be getting something for yourself, dear.
Oh, I want nothing more but a few dresses. And what will my boy get for himself?
I was wondering if I could pick up a car cheap. A small one. I think it would pay for itself really quickly and save so much by way of railway fares.
Of course it would. That's a splendid idea. Oh, there's May. We forgot May!
So we did. She must be getting something, of course.
Of course, something really substantial.
We won't have anything left by the end of the week if we're not careful.
The bills can all wait. They must. I always think family comes first, don't you?
Undoubtedly. After all, it is we who are making the money, and we have a right to spend it any way we like. Cold, dear.
A little. The weather's depressing, isn't it? If we were doing such good business, I'd be in the blues.
Strange how the weather broke the day after we opened. Not a gleam of sun since. However, it's all about business.
I was wondering whether we can run a children's matinee next week. Meet some nice dream or something like that. How can we do Tanya?
There's an idea. I've been being brought up.
Oh! Miss Constantia! What an afternoon! I'm dripping! Wouldn't you like a cup of tea?
Oh, we've had ours, thanks. And I'm just off to the pavilion.
Oh, I hope you had a good audience this afternoon. I wasn't able to go, unfortunately. The hotel takes up so much of my time.
We had a very good audience.
I'm glad. What's on tonight?
The Powers of Darkness!
Oh, that's the one where they murdered a baby in the cellar. I thought that was a very good one.
An extraordinarily powerful play.
Yes, indeed. Talking of babies and all, that reminds me that the business about Michael and Helena just goes from bad to worse. Annie had a terrible time this afternoon with Michael's mother.
I'm sorry to hear that. What happened?
It seems the mother drove over from Shangri stranded in Askhart, and she gave Annie all sorts, saying that her boy's character had been taken away and that the town had no right to be seen, as they are saying that there's nothing for poor Michael to do with Mary Helena. She blames it all on Annie for calling Michael out on his name. His real name, it seems, is Aloysius. Blaming Annie, mind you, was the best friend the poor girl ever had.
That seems very unfair. Ah, that's what always happens. The woman pays to the uttermost farthing.
Oh, yes. It's a troublesome world.
I don't think you have too many troubles, Miss Tweed. What with your nice place here, and your brother and sister-in-law so fond of you.
and with the interest of looking after the hotel.
I don't seem to take much interest in the hotel anymore. I don't know what's come over me. Anyway, it's not the same as having a real home of my own.
Oh, of course it's not. I know.
Oh, to have a house, to own the hearth and stool and all, the heaped up salts upon the fire, the pile of turf against the wall. To have a clock with weights and chains and pendulum swinging up and down, a dresser filled with shining dove, speckled white and blue and brown.
Oh, exactly, dear. Oh, takes a woman to understand a woman, if you'll excuse me, Mr. Delamere. I lay awake all last night thinking about that fae wife. Oh, I can never get the name right. It's like a cold in the head.
A cold in the head? I confess.
I know what she means, darling.
Chekhov,
isn't it, Miss Drake?
Yes, dear, Chekhov. Do you remember the woman in it? She had her chance and she threw it away. And there she was, drifting into middle age. Alone and neglected, just like myself.
You threw your chance away, Miss Dewey?
I did, dear, I did. If I hadn't been a foolish girl, I'd now be a TD's wife.
No.
A fact, Mr. Delamere.
Which TD?
Hush, Constance. We have no right to probe into such an old story.
Oh, it's such an old story. I can talk with now. Yes, I might.
Dear, dear.
And my picture in the papers and asked to parties in Dublin and all. And if I cared to, I could dress better than Annie. I've kept my figure better than she did. But what's the use in dressing grand? Sure, fine clothes are a poor consolation for a broken heart.
Very true.
Why did you throw him over?
I didn't throw him over, Miss Constantia. Peter Hurley behaved shameful. We weren't exactly engaged. Thank God I never gave him the chance to jilt me. But he behaved shameful all the same. He played with my affections and then, without so much as a by your leave, or with your leave, took himself off and married a small publican's daughter from the County Clare.
Too bad, too bad. Well, you must remember that sorrow's crown of sorrows is remembering happier days. You must be brave, Miss Dewey, and live for the next generation. Teach them to see clearer, to think straighter, and be more fearless.
Oh, I must, I suppose.
I'm jaded.
Indeed, Miss Dewey, you look worn out.
I thought I'd never live to be called such things as that woman called me this afternoon.
Did Mr. Dewey not deal firmly with her?
I've never seen John since dinner time.
He spent the whole afternoon in the bar.
Did he?
You'll have to speak to John, Annie. He's terrible the way he's drinking.
Not at all.
Though he's my own brother, I have to say it. You're married to a man who's on the high road to becoming a drunkard.
Lizzie, don't say such things. I hope I see John Spence as clearly as the next, but he's not, never was, and never will be a drunkard.
Well, I only hope you're right.
Everything's going as
Lady. We've been watching the play. They went to the end of the pier, stood there for a bit, and then left over. The tollboys were watching, since they pulled him out.
Only bruised?
Yes, ma'am. It is one of them congested piers, and when the tide is up, there's only a sup of water. He must be out of his senses to think he could drown there. Now, if he'd gone to the White Rocks, there'd be some catch for him.
Well, indeed, I'm glad he didn't.
He's roaring on the men and mother's place, saying it's there he will go the next time he has freedom. The doctor's with him. He says it's sort of melancholy.
Michael!
There's the boss calling for him.
Oh, it's a sad, sad world.
Everything's gone astray.
Yet, it is interesting to find a temperament like that here in Inish. We Irish, we're very much like the Russians, really.
Quiet on the surface, but with such hidden depths of feeling. Let me stoic here.
Is it Lizzie?
Yes, your sister-in-law has allowed us to know a little of her tragedy.
Her tragedy? In heaven's name, what are you talking about?
Do you see these?
I do, to be sure.
Do you know what they are?
They look like bills.
Then they look like what they are. Bills, bills, bills. This one from Kenneth's. This from Ireland's. These two from shops on Grafton Street. I've never heard of names of before. Woman, you want to ruin me?
I do not.
You've been drinking, John.
I have not. And if I had myself, wouldn't I have good reason to try and drown my troubles? Where in heaven's name am I getting money to pay all these?
There's not so much in them after all.
Not so much. Look here, £19.11. And here, £10.19. And here.
It's not very nice to be saying these things before Mr. Delamere and Miss Constantia.
Oh, as a matter of fact, I'm just going.
So am I.
I don't want Ireland to go. But I've got to say, to be heard by the whole world. I've tried to rear Eddie well and respectable, and leave a nice business behind for him. And here's my wife, stabbing me in the back of the time, buying a mountain of clothes, hats, ribbons and the like to flaunt around the town.
I'm sure Mrs. Tweed becomes him well and does your credit.
I think you should be proud of her.
Indeed, you should, Miss Constantia.
You say nothing.
No, but I'm taking a lot.
Slowly my eyes are being opened, and I begin to see what a fool I've been all these years. Just making a home for you, making a nest for you, making a
doll's house for her.
Exactly, a doll's house. You took the word out of my mouth.
You know, dear, it is the curious conversation of our Albert's case.
But it has got to stop. If it doesn't, one or the other of us leave this house.
John, you wouldn't dream of such a thing.
Why wouldn't I? I've got my own life to lead, haven't I? I'm not just a blank checkbook, am I?
The drop's by, John. Say, let's go to Dublin by the evening train. The day I'll meet tomorrow.
Well, isn't that a pity? You can't be with me to the play tonight.
Ah, no. Worse luck. But I think it's a shame that I'm taking any seat every night.
You're welcome to it, Peter.
Ah, thank you, Annie. Have you been out, Lizzie? I was asking, has you been out?
I think, Mr. Hurley, in the future, the less conversation you and I have together, the better.
Lizzie? Why so?
I needn't say.
What ails you, Lizzie?
Please ask me no questions, Annie. I've said my say.
Sure you can't leave it like that. And Peter, such an old friend of yours.
Old friend indeed.
Well, isn't he? Didn't you used to play together as child?
Maybe that's what I'm thinking of. And thinking too of the way he treated me when I wasn't a child any longer.
What does she mean, John?
I don't know. What's the matter, Lizzie girl?
Miss Tweed is no doubt thinking of the rather heartless way you behaved long ago.
Heartless?
Yes, heartless. When you abandoned her for another.
I never did anything of the kind. There was never anything between.
between us, except for maybe Elizabeth thinks it's skylarky now.
Oh, Peter! It may have seemed only skylarky to you, Mr. Hurley!
But it broke us to his heart.
Did it, Lizzie? I never heard a word of this.
Nor I. Such idolatry was never known. Don't be making an old idiot of yourself, Lizzie.
I'm sorry I intruded my personal tragedy on you all. I apologize. And now, John, your old agent of a sister retain yourself. Away!
Well, can you read that?
Don't I? Did you hear about Jim Fancy?
Of course I did. Everyone's talking of it. I'm sorry for the poor boy. And I'm sorry for ourselves, too. But there'll be one less in the audience every night, Mr. Delamere. Jim never missed a performance once.
I see. A real enthusiast.
But John, I'm uneasy about Lizzie. I mean, it's not that I have anything to blame myself about, but they've been out 20 more years ago. They've been the best of friends all along. She's been a good friend to my wife, too.
Don't give it a thought, Peter. Some little fancy that came to her. Maybe the weather's accounting for it. Don't feel at all myself this evening.
I see. Well, I'll be off.
Will you be staying in Dublin over the weekend?
No, I'll be back for Saturday. I wouldn't miss the play that night for anything. Good night to you all.
Good night.
Good night. I must be off too. Hector, are you ready to come?
Yes, I may as well go. I'll see your complaints then, Mr. Dewey.
Of course.
And Mrs. Dewey? No, thank you. I think I'll stay home and read a magazine or just watch.
Indeed. And what magazine is that?
Comic Cuts.
Indeed.
Did you mean that for a slap at them, Annie?
They can take it any way they like.
You don't care much about them, I think.
They're all right, I suppose.
Annie, I spoke too sharply to you a while ago, and I'm sorry.
You've a right to be. You disgraced me before the whole room.
Still those bills. They were a bit of a slap in the face, coming all by the one post.
I see that you're not troubled with any more. I'll never buy another dress in Dublin as long as I live. Old Peg Manan can run me up an old skirt and blouse if ever I need a new one. Once a year, maybe. And I suppose I can sell what I have to some second-hand place and get a few pounds for it. And every penny I get, I'll give to you.
Now. I don't want you to do anything of the sort. All I'm asking is for a little moderation.
I won't have my own husband tell me I flaunt around the town.
I shouldn't have said that. I don't know what came to me.
Take I know.
The drink.
I wasn't taking the drink at all.
Maybe it's getting hold of me. Like in that play, mm-hmm. Where the man went raving mad and threw the knife at his wife.
I'd like to see you throw so much as a spoon at me.
And there was another thing. Oh, but sure it was vodka they were drinking, not decent Irish.
You take those things too seriously. Sure, Charlie, it's only worth passing an evening.
Maybe I do, but they're powerful all the same. Anyways, those same things are doing well, I guess. I hear shangri sprams of vodka. Of course, the bad weather has killed the bathing, but even so, we have them bet. Those who have taken houses for the month are fit to be tied because they went there instead of here. And they're having to run two extra buses each evening to bring them across here to the pavilion. I believe the circus there is empty, and the manager of the Royal Challenge Train Shakespeare leaves the lounge. But even that won't keep them dropping over here. We're at the crest of the wave. Well, Eddie, son, how's tricks?
Fine.
Did you get to swim today, Eddie?
again you. It's about the way the old misunderstanding and how damnable everything is.
I see.
I think I'm going to get my tea. Are you coming, Eddie?
No. I think I'll stay in with Eddie for a bit. What's wrong, Eddie?
Nothing.
I don't like it being so rude to Pat.
I wasn't rude.
Oh, Miss Lambert, dear, you must be famished for your tea. It should have been here 30 minutes ago, but I can't do anything with Helga these days. I'll go fetch her.
Tired, Christine?
Just a bit. Hands were especially tangled today, and then there's the weather. Does it give you the hug?
No, it doesn't. I like it like this. When you think of the terrible things that happen in the world every day. Every day, Christine. It seems as if the sun had no right to shine at all.
That's a dreadful thing to say, Eddie.
Isn't it true?
No, I'm sure it's not. There are lots of lovely things in the world. Like little children and flowers and the sea. And all sorts of things.
Ah, but the children seem to suffer the worst of all. And the flowers die and the sea wrecks the ships.
Eddie, come off it.
What do you mean?
You'll be giving me the blues next. What's the matter? You're so solemn the last 2 days.
Perhaps I'm beginning to realize what life really means.
If you know that, then you'll know a lot. More than the wisest man ever knew.
I think one learns through suffering.
Good Lord! Excuse me. Eddie, tell me, have you ever thought about going to work?
I do work.
Not what I call work.
You want me to go away somewhere? Get a job?
Maybe.
Why should I? I have this place to walk into one day. I help pack in the business. I do quite a lot of work.
Seems soft.
I like to improve people, or rather help them to improve themselves.
But you have no ambition for yourself.
There was one time I had.
And when was that?
You know very well.
Oh?
You killed it stone dead when you turned me down time after time.
I want to live my own life. Free and independent. Or else marry a husband I can respect. Someone who's doing big important work, not a
son of a country hotel keeper with a grocery business and a bar at the back of the shop. Go on. Say it.
You said it.
Thank you. I see your point, Christine. You'd never have liked to have been my doll, my plaything.
No, Eddie, I wouldn't.
Quite right. But I too, Christine, have my life to live. My destiny to work out my...
Eddie, come off it. Can't you be nice though you used to be? We were as jolly as possible the day I arrived last week. Don't you remember?
Perhaps I didn't realize...
Oh, stop realizing. Be nice, Eddie.
You've not been so nice to me.
I'll try to be.
Here it is for the last time. Will you marry me?
Forget it, Eddie.
Never, never, not as long as I live, Christine, will you marry me?
No!
Thank you. I'm sorry I bothered you. I won't do it again.
I rather... Liked
him, Robert, you know? Did you? That shows how little you understood.
Oh, Miss Lambert, you're a woman of the world. What's a suicide pact?
Good heavens, surely we're taking. What are you talking about?
Tom Mooney of the Brigade has been telling me it's all over the town. A young couple at Shangri Strand turned the gas on, left a bit of a note, posted it to the girl's mother, in fact, saying 'twas a suicide pact. But sure, it was a penny in the snot meter, and it gave out. And I suppose the young couple got better of it, or they had no change in the house. Anyway, they're alive and little the worst of it.
What a wonderful escape. Who are they?
The young couple had a job, shifted scenery with Mr. Delamere, and the wife sold chocolates in the theatre. They'd come and go by bus every day to Shangri Strand. The man got dismissed last Saturday because he'd be all night with his eyes and ears glued to some crap in the scenery, listening to the plays and never doing a tap of work. But he came back every night this week, and the girl used to smuggle him into the back of the pit. It must have been on the head to losing his job that he tried to destroy himself.
There's some queer madness in the air. Everyone's behaving strange and different.
Why should you think them mad?
Might think what they're going to do be the most sensible thing in the world? To kiss and die?
Eddie, that's wicked shameful talk. Where's your religion and your common sense?
Now, common sense be hanged. Is life worth living?
I don't hold with suicide, Daddy. I never did. But in a way, Eddie's right. There are times when we all feel that life is not worth living.
Oh, I never felt that way. Thank God. Did you miss Lambert, dear?
It is just such a touch of the growing pains, Mrs. Twigg. I won't pay him too much mind.
That's right. Throw my youth in my face.
I didn't mean to do anything of the kind, dear.
You've always treated me as a child, and Mammy too. But I'll have you know I'm no longer a child.
Of course you're not, son.
And I'll have you know that I just asked Christine for the last time if she'll marry me. And she said no, so that's finished forever. And I'll let you and Pappy stop making jokes about me and her, or I'll do something that'll make us sorry.
The poor boy. Miss Lambert, dear.
I'm afraid it's no use, Mrs. Twigg. I'm very fond of Eddie, but that's as far as it goes.
Poor Eddie. I know what he's going through. I know.
Lizzie, don't be a fool.
That's what they'll call us, Eddie. Fools! Fools!
Glory be to goodness, I take your strain head too. Come, Miss Lambert, I'll get you your tea.
Poor Eddie. And poor me. Oh, Peter. Peter.
Arrested on charge of incendiarism.
Oh, poor King Maloney. Honest to man.
madame's between what depths and depths are in a person's character.
Oh, I know, I know. There's my tragedy.
Exactly. Is there any cheese?
I'm sorry to say we've run out of cheese.
No matter. Will you eat nothing yourself?
Oh, no thanks. Anything I took at this hour of the night would bray on my stomach. It amazes me to see Miss Constantia eating so heartily.
I've taken the merest crumb.
Oh, you're welcome to an everything, dear. Well, I must leave you for a few minutes. I must see if everything locked up downstairs. As I told you, the entire house is on my shoulders tonight. What is it, Michael?
Nothing, miss.
Sure it must be something.
It is a kind of message I have for Mr. Delamere.
Then out with it.
What is it, my boy?
It's a sort of private.
More troubles and mysteries. What's the word coming to when the boots is going to tell me to leave the room? I'm bothered out of my life.
What's the message, Michael?
This isn't exactly a message, ma'am.
No.
I couldn't say what I had to say before the old one.
The old one?
Oh, Lizzie Tweek.
What a respectful way to speak of your master's sister.
I was, ma'am. I was one of those. At school, I was always grand at recitations.
Yes.
I want to be an actor, sir.
Michael!
An actor? You?
Yes, sir.
No, no, my poor boy. Any profession save that.
Why so?
I think, if I had my life to live again, I'd rather be the Boots at the Seville Hotel than Hector Delamere.
See you the Boots?
Yes.
You don't know what you're talking about. Do you know the kind of life I lead? Up every morning at 6:30, cleaning knives, cleaning boots, knocking up commercial travelers out of their beds, powerful sleepers, every one of them. Rousing Helena to get the breakfast, coming to grips the early train, snatching white breakfast myself, God knows when. Being the hens in the broad sound, being a bit of odd gardening, meeting every train that comes and goes, serving in the shop, carrying coals and whiskey up here, never seeing my own bed till midnight or later. I got along with you, sir.
Even so, it would be better then.
If I was the lightest of you, you'd be traveling the length and breadth of the world. Maybe England, maybe the whole wide world itself. You'd be speaking grand speeches, wearing fine clothes. You'd be having people frozen cold in their seats with the terror out of them. The way you stiffened myself out the other night. I'd have them rocking themselves sick with the laughing. Not me, that you were much of a comic, Mr. Denham. Name for myself, that I'd be remembered throughout the land. I'd not just be Michael the Boots at the Seaview. And even to say Michael, not be my Christian name at all.
I shall always call you Aloysius in the future, Michael.
Thank you, ma'am.
You'd like to give up your nice place here, with your kind master and mistress, to drag from one small town to another, playing in small halls and dirty little theatres, staying in frowsy lodgings with no home, no permanent abiding place. Watching yourself getting older and shabbier with every year.
Hector, what are you saying?
It's true, Constance, it's true. You know it is. Always saying to myself, will I ever get a chance? Must it always be the smallest of England and Ireland for me? Oh, my. To play, even for one night, a great tragic role in a great theatre with thousands hanging on every word I uttered.
That's it, sir. That's it. Oh, I know, sir. But if you'd only hear me recite.
No. No.
Please, sir.
Let him, dear. It can do no harm.
Very well. Proceed.
What's that? A comic or serious?
I think I should prefer something serious.
Well, I learned this after I left school. It wasn't in the reading book, but I took a fancy to it. place in the mountains of Canicore. A great place for the year. He came from Ballyverney, and we called him Ballyverney. Sweetest name in Erin I've been all. And they tell me that he has taken now the last long journey. And it's young he is, it's young. He is so very far to go. For eyes just like a flower, we saw his life unfolded. As day by day, he grew and bloomed in early manhood's grace. Ah, death, to pluck the flower and to snatch from our beholding the head of rippled gold and the happy morning face. Sure, that's a sad old poem. Maybe like this one.
Thank you. front of page news maybe tomorrow.
Front page? Oh, you're from a newspaper.
Yes, I thought I had explained that. I'm not from any particular paper. I'm freelance. Part of my business to read all the Irish papers every day. And in the last 2 weeks, one word has caught my eye again and again. Inish. Attempted suicide at Inish. Boy breaks open till in shock at Inish. Respectable butcher, Mr. McCloskey, beats his wife at Inish. Young couple attempts suicide pact. Couple employed at Inish. Now, I happen to know Inish. My sister and I spent a month here 2 summers ago for our sins. It was deadly dull and very expensive.
Where did you stay?
Not here. You were even more expensive. But that's not the point. The point is, during that month, nothing happened. There wasn't even a decent dogfight. And now all of this in 10 days. An outbreak like this doesn't come together by chance. I've been putting 2 and 2 together. The first journalist in all of Ireland puts particular 2 and 2 together. And I'm here this morning to find out what they make.
Well, I don't understand, obviously. But sure, there was nothing at the back of that boy breaking into McGarry's tail, except he wanted Manny to go to the theatre. McGarry let him off, and Mr. Delamere gave him a season ticket, and there's been no more about it.
Yes. I hadn't thought there was anything in that particular incident. I've been all around town this morning. Came from Dublin on the early train. Been into shops and pubs, and I've noticed the strangest kind of attitude in the people. Everyone is suspicious, watching everyone else, expecting something strange to happen. And if you mention anyone to anyone else, you're met with a kind of veiled suggestion that they might not be what they seem to be, that they have a shady past, and are likely to have a blacker future. I hasten to add that no one has said a word against you, Miss Twig.
Did you mention my name?
I don't think I did.
Well, let you try mentioning it and see what happens. You're right, Miss Haggerty. This town is full of gossipers and slanderers, and I can tell you things about some of them that would make your hair stand on end.
But they weren't like this 2 years ago. They were nice, ordinary people. A little on the dull side. Mr. There is something at the back of all of it. What is it?
Well, indeed I couldn't tell you. Unless it would be the weather. Rain every day for a fortnight.
If rain were accountable for crime, all of Ireland would have murdered itself long ago. No. No, it can't be the weather.
Maybe it's politics. Then the weather about the only things we think of outside your own business.
Yes, I haven't thought of politics. Perhaps it's a curious result of the recent legislation. Perhaps your local TD could help elucidate that point.
Is it Peter Hurley?
Yes.
You'd do well not to go near Peter Hurley. He's the deceiver if there ever was one.
In what way?
I'd rather not see. It's a personal matter. But be deceitful in one way, and you'd be deceitful in every way. Isn't that right, Miss Haggerty?
I suppose so.
Anyway, you can't see him today because he's away in Dublin at the dead.
That's right. There was a very important Dublin sitting last night.
Oh, imagine poor old Ireland depending on the votes of men like Peter Hurley. I have to laugh.
The division was likely to be very close.
Oh, they can depend on Peter. Peter both the way he's toad to vote. The creature hasn't the courage of a mouse. Oh, come in. This young lady is from a newspaper. Mr. Delamere and Miss Constancia, Miss Haggerty.
You wanted to interview me?
Well, I'm not sure.
Or perhaps it's Miss Constancia you want to talk to.
Oh no, please, Hector, you know how I hate publicity. And all my pictures are at the theatre.
There are times, dearest, when one must sacrifice oneself to the great hungry public.
I'm just looking for general information.
Well,
we started our season nearly 3 weeks ago, and we've had the most, I won't say astonishing, because I believe the public at heart, a fond, as the French say, is quite sound and wants the best. Fine plays, well presented, mind you, and with suitable decor. I admit that our decor is not at present all as it might be. You understand, Miss Hegarty, the exigencies of continual touring.
Oh, you're actors!
Well, I hope we are actors. Are we, Constance, my love?
The Dunamere Repertory Company, Miss Hegarty. Miss Haggerty's from Dublin, and she's maybe a bit out of touch with things. You'll must forgive her.
Oh, I quite understand.
And there's nothing to forgive.
We haven't played in Dublin for years. When were we there last, darling?
Oh, I really can't remember.
What theatre did you play in?
One of the big ones. Of course. I don't remember which.
And you're doing well here?
We've been doing extraordinarily well up to this week. Miss Twig, perhaps you can explain the curious falling off of audiences this week.
I cannot. And I don't know why everyone this morning is asking me to explain everything.
Well, I'm sure the repertory was varied enough. Some new plays and some old favorites. But you know, when it comes, at least only a handful. Things always seem to be happening in this town, and everybody is so busy talking about what has just happened or waiting for the next thing to happen to have any time or inclination to come to the pavilion.
Ah! So you've noticed it too?
Noticed what?
An accumulation of a... incidents of a mildly criminal nature.
Oh, there have been many strange things which have not got into the papers.
Oh, that's extraordinarily interesting.
That's extraordinarily distressing, Miss Haggerty. And as a consequence, we play to empty houses.
Never mind, dear. We have learned to take the rough with the smooth.
We have. 'Tis not in mortals to command success, but we'll do more, Sempronius.
We'll deserve it.
Bravo.
Oh, I wish you could see some of their plays, Miss Haggerty. They're gorgeous, though sometimes it's a bit hard to sleep after them. That one, Mr. Dillamere, where you throw the lamp at Miss Constantia and you're then put in a string waistcoat, that was a very good one. But of course, my favorite is the one where they murder the baby in the cellar.
Perhaps you come to the theatre tonight, Miss Hegarty. Any representative of the press is, of course, more than welcome.
I'm afraid I have to get back to Dublin.
I see. Shall you be here for a little time?
I think so. At any rate, I'll be lumping around the town to the afternoon train.
I thought, Constance, perhaps we could take a walk to the pavilion and check for letters, and if we chance to come across any photographs, Miss Hegarty would like to have them. Just as a little souvenir, Miss Hegarty. Just as a little souvenir.
Thank you very much.
We won't be more than a moment. The pavilion is just around the corner. Constance, will you come?
Yes, I should like a walk. I want to feel the sea spray beating on my face.
I'm afraid it's quite calm this morning, dear. The sun was trying to come out a little while ago.
What matter? I shall at least get a breath of ozone.
Shall I reserve your seat as usual, Miss Twig?
Oh no, I can't come tonight.
You've missed every night this week. 5-5.
No one is sorrier than myself. But I don't like the way Eddie's going on at all, and I want to keep an eye on him.
Dear, dear.
What's happened to Eddie, Miss Twig?
Haven't you noticed it's him yourself? So dark and shut up in himself? And worse than that, he's broken his pledge.
Oh, Miss Twig.
Yes, dear. Never took a drop in his life until now. I feel quite frightened.
Where is he?
I don't know. He's not around the house. I'm sorry, Mr. Dillamere, but I must stay at home tonight.
It's quite all right, Miss Twig. Quite all right. Constance, let us go.
Why, yes.
And happy?
Very happy.
You're one of the few lucky ones, so come in. Oh, good morning, Miss Slattery.
Good morning, Miss Twig.
My brother is out. Can I do anything for you?
You're just the one that can. Just see that?
I do, to be sure.
Tis a grand weed killer you sold to Mick Tone in a few years back. I want one the like of it. And they told me below in the shop, 'twas you had the key to all the poisons.
I have, to be sure. Oh, kill him quick. Oh, Miss Lattery. Isn't it a pity? We're not allowed to stalk that one any longer. 'Twas too poisonous altogether.
Oh, is that so? Well, have you anything in the nature of rat poison?
I have.
Name before the public. I want to make it quiet.
Here,
out of
of attempted murders and suicides and God knows what. I hear no more of them.
Is it? Well, I beg your pardon.
That's all right, Miss Lambert. Out of the suit.
But really?
No more talk. Master Eddie's right as a rain. I'll be here in a minute.
They told me that the factory had been dropped. We should.
Bad enough to them for storytellers.
Then they told me the streets had only gotten out.
Let you sit down. You were all a tremble.
Thank you, Mr. Mooney.
I'll see that they send any home. She could have some clothes and a drink of brains. Miss Lambert, if you'll excuse the intrusion, we have all the great respect for John to the family. And I didn't start anything to happen to Eddie.
Happen to Eddie? But he's safe, isn't he?
He isn't one way, and he isn't another. It'll be my business, I'm afraid, to find out what brought him into the wire today. And back in your apartment, it'll be a little bit your business, too.
I had nothing to do with it. What do you mean? What do you accuse me of?
No, there's no use crying out at me. I'm too old, and I'm married, and that makes me patient. Now, everyone in town knows you and Master Eddie, and everyone likes the two of you, and that's a sweet little place John has outside of town.
I don't know it.
Tis well you know it. The last time you were down here, didn't I see you and Eddie walking the land? Smart land with a tiny little gun. All going out of place because John's too busy living up there? A damage in the house. A woman living up there would be crowned. However, I won't get into that. I'll just think that under certain circumstances, I might provoke the charges I might have against the young gentleman in question. I think I hear him coming. Come in here, Eddie, before you go to your room. There's someone who wants to see you.
Who is it?
This is Lambert.
No, I can't come in.
In with you and no nonsense. Here he is for you, Miss Lambert.
Eddie, darling.
Exactly.
My poor darling, what happened to you?
Let me go, Christina. I'm drinking. I want to change.
No, darling, what happened?
Nothing.
Nothing? Nonsense, what did you do?
Well, I was on a rock, and I got giddy, and I fell into the sea.
Maybe you couldn't have started to turn on the sun, but it's not good enough for me. Won't you tell me?
You're so miserable, Christine.
I know, darling.
It didn't seem worth going on with.
I know.
There seemed no hope you could ever come out, right?
Yes, darling.
So I tried to make an end of it all.
My poor darling.
No good at living, Christine.
Hush, hush.
But if I'm no good at living, I'm as bad at dying. For the minute I felt the cold of the water, it runs me out of it quick and go on living. And unfortunately, I'm an awfully strong swimmer, so... I just swam ashore and that's all.
Darling.
Wasn't I the fool to try and destroy myself by drowning? I should have tried any other way but that.
Darling, do you realize I've called you darling about a dozen times in the last 2 minutes?
Have you, Christine?
Yes, darling.
You don't mean? Oh, Christine!
Of course, I mean. Eddie, if you'd been drunk, I'd have been the next off that rock and then I can't swim.
Upstairs, Jenny, does your red teens?
Yes, ma'am. But Christine says you're...
I think I know quite well what Christine says, but off with you. We don't want you to catch it at the world.
No, mammy. Very well, mammy. I won't be 5 minutes changing Christine.
You'll have a hot bath and you'll go straight to bed. Your husband has everything ready for you.
Yes, mammy. But I'm not going to bed.
I had to hunt him, Miss Lambert, dear. We don't want him down on our hands with pneumonia.
Do you mind, Mrs. Tweed?
Mine?
me again. I want to know. Every year's matter what?
Well, just not my sitting, as you know. The late Minister for Agriculture made a terrible powerful speech and...
To hell with the late Minister for Agriculture. Why did you listen to him?
I couldn't sort of help it. He made a terrible powerful speech and...
And you let yourself be swayed
by a little bit of mob oratory.
It was not mob oratory, John. It was not. It was facts and figures and...
Facts and figures? What the hell business have you with facts and figures? Your business is to vote with the government.
I know, but...
What?
But it was that play, the enemy of the people. Do you remember it, John? I couldn't get it out of my head.
Oh, those bloody plays.
Do you remember how Doctor the play said nobody should have to act as if they'd have to spit in their own face? Well, I thought the guys would have had to tell the truth. And the only way to do that, John, I am no speechifier, was by my vote.
So you voted against the government?
I did.
And defeated the bill?
Yes.
And now the government has to go to the country?
I suppose so.
Suppose so? Don't you know? And don't you know that this place is disgraced forever in the eyes of the world? What? Thunder and turf, man! What's to become of public life at all if members of Parliament start being swayed this way and that? By speeches and arguments and facts and figures! By that! There's an end to all stability in public affairs. Nobody will know where they stand. No party will know from day to day whether it has majority or not. It's chaos, man! Pure chaos!
I know! I'll never do it again!
You'll never have a chance to do it again, me bucko! You think you're going to be a candidate for the next election?
I suppose I won't.
I know you won't.
But it was that play! The enemy of the people!
The enemy of the people? Hey, that's you! That's your name from this out!
I in the car coming home, John. But I lived as far as Shanghai Strand, and I came on my bus. I'm afraid to face the wife, but she herself is mad about the same play.
Ah, don't talk to me about those plays. They have been the ruination of this place. However, thanks to Annie, I've already made up my mind to deal with them. You better be off home, Peter, and get it over with. We'll be friends again one of these days. But for the next week, for goodness sake, keep out of my sight.
Very well, John.
Annie! Annie!
Yes, John?
Come here! It's worse than you thought.
What is?
That play business. Peter Hurley's put off the government for them. It's a blasted play.
Heaven's name, that's awful, John.
It's a national tragedy. And to think, we're to blame for it all. giving you this. £50? What's this for? Maybe you don't remember that it was our agreement that the contract at the pavilion could be terminated without notice on either side upon payment of £50.
Oh, but I do not understand. I admit that the audiences this week have been a disappointment, a sore disappointment, but I am confident that they will improve as the week goes on.
Miss Joyce bought 3 seats while we were there just now.
It has nothing to do with the audiences.
Well, you can't have any complaints against the acting, I'm sure.
I have nothing against the acting. It's very good.
Too good.
Or the conduct of the company?
No. Decent people, every one of them.
Well, then I repeat, I do not understand.
Well, it's this way. Queer things have started to happen here. Things that haven't happened in 50 years. And it was Annie who put her finger on the root of the trouble.
What sort of things do you refer to, Mr. Dewey?
You know very well, Miss Constancia. Nasty things that were getting Inish into the paper.
And what have we to do with such things?
Annie, maybe you can explain it better than I can.
In a word, it's all you and your plays, Mr. Lemaire. And mind, I'm not saying a word against you personally, or Miss Constancy either. But maybe they're too good for us, or we're too simple for them. I remember saying the day you came that we were blue moldy for want of an innocent scandal or two. Well, it seems there are plenty of scandalous things going on in town that no one would be thinking of, except the parties concerned. We were all more or less happy and comfortable. Good nature and jolly until those plays came and started putting ideas into our heads. People became suspicious of their neighbors and of their own families. The young people got asking themselves, is life worth living? I've heard that question asked once in the last week. I've heard it asked a dozen times. My own boy asked it to me, and you never before do we think of asking ourselves such a ridiculous question.
It is far from ridiculous, Mrs. Chewing. Is life worth living? But how often one did.
Nonsense, ma'am. Of course it is. You have your faith, Mrs. Chewing. I have my religion, Miss Constancia. Did you ever see a large stone in a field, Mr. Delmare?
Of course I did.
You might be sitting by to find it on some sunny afternoon. And then, from your reason to talk, you turn it over. And what would you find? Worms, horrible little creeps that run this way and that, little beetles that make your stomach churn. What would you do? You turn the stone back over as quick as you could, or you'd run away.
I see. We have lifted the stone. We have exposed the niche. Constance, it's wonderful. We have a mission here, a great duty.
Oh, no, sir, you haven't. Your duty is to get yourself and your traps out of the hall as quick as you can. Penny and I saw the Monsignor early this morning, and he agrees with the course that I've taken.
He agrees there must be a stop. Don't you think we're going to the suicide pact in the head of his life worth living?
What nonsense. It shows great moral courage.
Why, I mean that you're running away. Never did before in Ireland.
You know you can't turn us out like this at a moment's notice.
The agreement says I can, and things are so desperate that I have to stick by that agreement, even if it seems a bit hard on you. You know we have a murderer on our conscience, if only by the good luck. McCluskey, the butcher, is such a bad shot with a hatchet.
I don't believe that had anything to do with our plays.
And Tommy McCluskey, in the front row every night. Of course, we all knew he fought an hour to get with Julia. But the night he threw the hatchet was the night he came home after watching Mr. Delamere throw the lamp at you.
But there are a number of seats booked for tonight. Are you going to disappoint all those people?
They'll get their money's worth.
In what way?
It was on the phone this morning, Shangri Strand. I'm having a circus over.
A circus?
It's on the road now. We'll be in the town any minute.
This is an insult. A deliberate insult.
It's not another kind.
You are a narrow-bigoted man. You're afraid of the truth. And your wife is worse.
She's an ignorant provincial. She's only seen our work twice!
What? Was enough.
We were giving you great art. I have played here as I have never played before. And Mr. Delamere has given himself, all of himself, night after night, to an audience of clodhoppers. And when we stir something in this cause, waking up to some spark of life, you say they must go to sleep again. And you broke them to sleep with a circus? It's an insult to them and to us.
I don't know what you mean by awakening them to life, Miss Constanza. Seems to me you're awakening them to kill each other or themselves. You say mean, slanderous things of one another to...
And to put up the government. Ooh, what a king that Peter Hurley.
The long and the short of it is, you must be gone. You are doing no good here.
Do you really mean this?
I do.
I can only say that I am sorry. I think you are mistaken, tragically mistaken. But you have treated us fairly all along, and I'm not going to stoop to a sordid quarrel. My wife has said some things she should not have, but I know that you will forgive her.
Sure, dear. I'm sorry for you. We were so happy here. You were all so kind to us. I thought we were friends for the whole summer. I am so tired of you driving from place to place.
You mustn't keep going. Not until you've found where you can stay. This is your home, for as long as you care to stay. Isn't that right, John?
To be sure it is. I'll take it badly if you went away in a huff.
Sure, call me Annie.
I appreciate your attitude, Mrs. Tuig. And I'm grateful for your offer of hospitality. I think we shall avail ourselves of it for a few days. I think it shall only be for a few days, for our success here has had reverberations elsewhere. And I have in my pocket at least two very good offers.
I'm more than delighted to hear that.
Let us go to the pavilion, dear. And start to pack.
Very well.
Oh, yes. Mrs. Tuig, if that lady from the newspaper comes back, this, could you give her this? It contains some photographs she particularly asked for.
Certainly.
Keep a couple scenes for us tonight. It's been 20 years since I've seen the circus.
Well, that's over. It will be very nice.
They did, the creatures.
I think I deserve a little drink after that.
Will you do it, to be sure?
You want to make a cup of tea for yourself.
I think I'll have a glass of port instead.
Annie, what's come over you?
I don't know. I feel so light in the heart, as if a big cloud has gone.
Faith, you're welcome to a bucket of port. Here's a wine glass full to begin with.
Helena, where were you? I've been looking everywhere for you.
I know, miss. I was at the chapel, ma'am.
Chapel this hour in the morning? What for?
I was getting married, ma'am.
Merciful heavens, who to?
Michael, of course. Who else?
My poor girl. This is what's come of all that nasty talk. I should have told you not to mind a word they said, and not to tie yourself up for life with a man who's worth no more to you than the next.
It's not that we tell, ma'am. Michael and me have been promised to each other for the last 2 months. Only, I could never bring myself to tell him about. You know what? I was delighted it slipped out of my mouth that morning. Anyway, to stop tongues wagging, we thought we might as well get married at once.
Well, thunder and turf. That's one good thing to believe in, anyhow. Where's Michael?
Outside the door, listening. Michael, you can come in and back on the top.
Oh, there's the boy.
us.